Jeff, I show a color magnitude diagram of brown dwarfs that Jeremy showed, and typically, if you look at brown dwarf in this diagram, you have hundreds of objects, and if you go at the high top of this diagram, you have a temperature of 2,500K objects down to 250K at the bottom. And if you do a classic radiative convective equilibrium model, 1D, as we discussed during also Alison's talk, you're getting something like that, typically. But it does not work at all. And you need something to reduce the flux actually in the Y and J band here. And traditionally, what has been used is clouds. And, when you introduce clouds, you're blocking the flux in the Y and J band, and you can go on the color magnitude diagram in that direction. Then at some point, you need the clouds to be removed so that you go back here. And then you still need other type of clouds when you go down. What we have done in a series of papers to show that there is another solution that is actually to reduce the temperature in the deep layers. And it does actually the same thing, because the Y and J band flux are coming from deep layers. If these layers are cooler, they will emit less flux. And you end up with the same effect. So what was also really cool with this solution is that it seems to work very well, and we can explain almost all, if not all, brown dwarf spectrum, including, for example, these guys that are the low gravity one and are very difficult to reproduce currently with cloud models. But with this reduced temperature gradient, it fits very well. Hope it's come back. Yep. But one thing then is to understand why you could reduce in such a way the temperature gradient, because it's not really obvious. One way you can think of it is that if you reduce the temperature gradient, you're reducing the radiative flux in the atmosphere. So you need something to compensate that. So one possibility is actually to have convection being more efficient. It's also a bit counterintuitive, because usually convection should bring you to the adiabat. And here is going to reduce the temperature gradient away from the adiabat. So you kind of need an explanation for that. One clue to the solution, I think, is actually to realize that what is truly correlated with the LT transition. If you look at the object, all these guys here, they are CO dominated. And all these guys here, they are CH4 dominated. So at the same time, you have your transition between the L and T dwarf here, you have the transition between CO and CH4. So it's really completely correlated to chemistry. So what if the chemistry, the transition between CO CH4, is able to impact the convective behavior in the atmosphere and produce at the same time the reddening? So in order to check that, actually we needed to extend the theory of convection to be able to check what's going on with the chemistry and all type of stuff. And during this process, we realized that actually it can encompass a lot of systems that are already known. So if I ask you what is common between all these things, the obvious answer is, I want to make in the talk, is that they are convective. But what's important is that it's not adiabatic convection. So as we heard during Alison's talk, in Earth atmosphere, the important thing is that it's not adiabatic. You have pumping and release of latent heat because of condensation of evaporation of water vapor and liquid water. Actually, it's kind of the same thing in the cooling system of a nuclear power plant. It's quite interesting. And to cool the nuclear power plant, you're using water. And you also have a phase transition of the formation of little steam bubble in the system. So you have the same phenomenon happening with the pumping and release of latent heat. In the ocean also, it's not adiabatic convection. It's what is called thermohaline convection, because you have salt in water and salt can diffuse. So you have source terms and the transport equation of salt, and you have also a diffusion of temperature. And this stuff has been also invoked to happen in stars, in the interior of stars, replacing salt by heavy elements. So, all this stuff, what is really important is that it's not adiabatic in a sense that you have energy exchange through latent heat, thermal diffusion, radiative transfer, or you have also compositional source term, chemical reactions, condensation, evaporation, composition of diffusion. So if we go back to quickly to thermal and convection, the criterion for convective instability is this one, where here you have the diffusion coefficient of salt and here the temperature diffusion coefficient. And what it's doing in the ocean is that it creates, for example, thermoline figuring staircase. So you're going to have these steps that are actually convective adiabatic, which means isothermal in the ocean because water is incompressible. So an adiabatic layer is going to be isothermal. And in between them, you're going to have fingering convection that is going to produce a completely inverted temperature gradient. So it reduces the temperature gradient compared to the isothermal one. And if you go to mass convection, so actually Alison told us everything we need to know about it, and she would probably explain that much better than I do. But the point I will make is that compared to dry convection, it does the same thing. It reduces the temperature gradient in the atmosphere, as Alison explained this morning. And the criterion for convection is this one, complicated one with this term. That depends on the latent heat and on the saturation. So what we did, just to go back to the theory. So if we go back to the standard case, thermal adiabatic case, you can describe everything in terms, mainly in terms of the advection of entropy. And here I put that in terms of the log of the potential temperature. And Jeremy also explained that just before. If you do an inner stability analysis of the thing, you end up with the Schwarzschild criterion, comparing your temperature gradient to the adiabatic gradient, and you're unstable to that criterion. If you go a bit further than that, as Jeremy also explained, you can put composition, transport of composition. If your mean molecular weight depends on composition, then you end up with the Ledoux criterion here, with the impact of the mean molecular weight gradient. And if you have heavy stuff on top of light stuff in terms of mean molecular weight, it's going to be unstable, as Jeremy pointed it out. What we have done actually is just to build on that and add source terms to the equation on a completely general one. It can be a function of anything. Well, it's a function of composition of temperature, but it can be any function. And if you do that and you carry on the linear stability analysis, you end up actually with two conditions for instability. The Ledoux one that we are going to call now adiabatic criterion because it does not involve the source term, and the new one here that actually depends on coefficient omega prime x and omega prime t that are a function of the partial derivative of the source terms. And we call this new criterion the diabatic one because here source terms are going to be important for this one. And what was really interesting to realize is that all the convective systems I was talking about are actually falling into that regime, and you can put them into the same context. It was pretty obvious for thermoline convection because it's just replacing our coefficients by diffusion, so it's pretty direct. But what was much more interesting was to realize that most convection can also be put in the same form, and it was not obvious at all, and I think has not been seen in the Earth climate community that thermoline convection and most convection can be the two faces of the same coin. The way it works, basically, just assuming that you are at saturation or at equilibrium if you're considering general chemistry, and this guy here is going to be split up into a component that is proportional to grad T and a proportional that, a part that can be proportional to grad ad, and then you factorize with the rest and you end up with that. But just a bit of algebra, but you get it out pretty straightforwardly. So you have the same general criterion that can explain all this situation. And the interesting part is that it could be used for the cooling system of nuclear power plants. It's a bit more complicated because it's a truly diphasic system with two different equations of state, but we have done also the generalization for that. It's because I'm working in a nuclear research center. So yeah, all these situations that can enter this this criterion, and probably many more. And the point then is that you can probably add Brandwarf into the system, replacing the source term for chemistry by the conversion between COCH4 and the source term for energy by radiative transfer. And the way it works is pretty simple. With most convection, when a bubble goes up, the temperature gets down, you have the fraction of liquid that goes up, and you can heat up your atmosphere. And you can build a bit of a similar picture for COCH4 radiative convection. You move it up, the temperature decreases, a fraction of CH4 increase because at low temperature CH4 is more stable. It increases your opacity, then you heat up your gas. So it's a way to describe it when the important term is the dependence of the source term, energy source term on composition. And there is another way that depends on mean molecular weight that Jeremy mentioned. It takes a bit more time to explain. To go further than that, to explain, to see if it could work in Brandwarf, we needed to generalize mixing length theory. And to do that, what we realize is that in the adiabatic case, what is conserved is entropy, the log of potential temperature. It's not conserved in the adiabatic case because of the source term, but in the linear regime, you can build a new quantity, a redefinition of entropy that is conserved in the linear regime and include these terms that depend on composition. And when you're building your mixing length theory, either you take the adiabatic case and you have the standard adiabatic flux that depends on the grad T minus grad ad, as usual. Either you can use this new conserved quantity in the adiabatic case and gives you this extra term here that depends on composition. And it's because of this extra term that then you can reduce the temperature gradient in your atmosphere. And actually, this idea is not coming from anywhere. It's actually completely inspired by what is done in Earth climate community to model Mohs convection, because Mohs convection is not resolved in JSM, it's parameterized. So you need a parameterization like a mixing length theory type. And the way it works is to redefine potential temperature to include the latent heat content into this redefinition. And you end up with the same type of formulation in the GCM. So we did that for Brandwarf, and typically with that model, we are able to reduce the temperature gradient as expected. So with COCH4 radiative convection. So it should work. The last thing that is very interesting is actually that it's a switch. You have an OR here. And as I said, you can be unstable, either to be unstable to the adiabatic case or the diabatic case, which means that you can have bifurcation in the system. And to see how often it can be, I will go back to a nuclear power plant on the cooling system, and I will explain what is a boiling crisis. Actually, something you're doing every day if you're loving pasta. So you're just heating some water. So you're putting a plate on which you impose the flux and you measure the temperature. At the beginning, you increase the flux, so the temperature rises, and you have convection to reduce, to extract the energy from your plate. And at some point, you have what is called nucleate boiling. So you're forming little bubbles of steam water in the system. And actually, that it changes the convective behavior because you can increase a lot the flux, and the temperature of the plate is not increasing so much. It's because convection is more efficient, because you extract energy through the phase transition to form the little bubbles. They are going to pump latent heat. And it's actually used in the nuclear system, in the cooling system of nuclear power plants, because it's more efficient to extract energy from the nuclear fuel. The problem is that at some point, there's a little problem that you can form a complete water vapor film around your heating plate. And then convection is going to be start to be really, really inefficient, and you have a complete transition back to adiabatic convection into the film. And here you have a transition like that, which is between 100 degrees at the plate to 1,000 degrees. So it's called a nuclear accident, typically. And if you have watched the Chernobyl miniseries, they're talking about it at some point as a thermal explosion. It's typically what's happening. So try to avoid it in a nuclear reactor. What's fun is that with our theory, we tend to think that we can explain that. By adding this extra term here, we can model the fact that here convection is more efficient. And the switch between the two then is the switch between diabatic and adiabatic convective fluxes. And why is it important for Brandwarf? Because we think it's the same thing that is happening, but in a reverse way. Because in Brandwarf, we are looking at the cooling sequence. So here we're basically cooling. We go on the, when COCH4 transition starts to be important with the reaction, we go onto the branch with diabatic convection, and you have a lower temperature in the deep atmosphere. At some point, you have this transition to go back to the adiabatic case, where a warming up of the deep layer that can explain the G-bond brightening in the cooling sequence. And if you play a bit with the diagram, just for fun, it really seems that you're seeing that directly into the color magnitude diagram, typically. That's why we call that now possibly a giant cooling crisis by similarities with the boiling crisis in a two-phase flow. So just to finish, maybe you are still skeptical about this. I think it's good. We all should be, because it's how we make progress. But I think it's also needed now to be a bit skeptical about the role of clouds in brand warfare, because there starts to be many problems. So I think there starts to be a consensus that there is a need for a reduced temperature gradient to explain the spectrum of T-Y dwarf, the recent Leggett paper. And still, the main problem also for cloud models is that they do not reproduce very well low gravity objects where they're supposed to work best, because they're supposed to be the one with the highest amount of clouds. And the main point also is that we have only one LT transition when we're crossing tens of condensation curves. Why only one and not an LT transition for each of the condensation curve we cross? So I think it's probably really important now that we revisit what we think we know about clouds in brand warfare, so that we get that right. And it's going to be really important to get right the role of clouds in giant exoplanets and rocky exoplanets.
Elena Manjabacas, Keck Observatory. So I'm not an expert on modeling, but I have worked a lot on brown dwarf variability. And up to now, we know that brown dwarfs are variable all the way from LTs and Ys. So how would you explain with your models brown dwarf variability in the way we observe it now?
So we are currently working on it with Daniel Appay and Bev Bilar. So basically, I can reproduce all the variable signatures in brown dwarf just by doing temperature variation. So with temperature fluctuations, you can reproduce most of it without the need to introduce clouds.
Okay, I'm looking forward to see that paper. Thank you.
One question over here. Very nice theory talk. Thank you. I just want to come back to your last question. I think this question is just a bit naively posed, because you don't cross 10 condensation curves, right? Because it's a formation process, so this basically implies you have equilibrium condensation, which doesn't work.
Okay.
One last question. Let's thanks again for the time.